topic of my short speech today is evaluating of features and moments and information regarding the implementation of Kubernetes cluster on three most famous cloud platform. I mean, of course, AWS, Microsoft Azure, and of course, GCP. Good. So, why I've chosen exactly this topic? Because the current situation is a bit different that we had before. I mean, a couple of years ago, we had no chance to, or had a small chance to select the proper, the most appropriate platform to implement our Kubernetes cluster, because not all the providers provided such opportunity. You know that Amazon started providing Kubernetes as service not long time ago. Anybody remember when exactly Amazon started do that? No? Okay, in this case, who from the people present here are dealing with Kubernetes overall? I mean, based and deployed on cloud platform.
Certainly there are some.
Okay. Good. So the question is, we have three cloud platforms and the task or goal is to select the most appropriate. So we will don't touch the cases when this selection already done by, as for example, clients' preferences or already existing deployments. So, okay, the task is to select the most appropriate one. Good. Do you see my screen, by the way?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So the preliminary agenda is general information, service limits, because you know not all the implementations and not all the services are the same on different cloud platforms. Network security, container, image service, of course, because without this, container registry, we will not be able to do something or will be able with a lot of security limitations and some kind of notes on data and sources. So, by the way, I also would like to ask you to interrupt me at any time, ask any kind of questions, et cetera, provide your personal cases on the projects and the same. So I would like to interact, but not only to provide a bit some information. So, okay, of course. So you probably know that all the three mentioned cloud providers, I mean, Amazon, Google, and Microsoft Azure are the members of Cloud Native Computing Foundation, right? So without the approval, without the adopting of rules and limitation and recommendation of this organization, probably we will not be able to use or will be able to use such solutions on cloud platforms, but with a lot of risk. So all these three providers are the member of this foundation. Okay, and let's start with the general information. The structure of presentation I selected in form of repeatable tables, right? And with parameters on the left side, and the right side is divided appropriately to cloud provider and the native Kubernetes platform. Let's start with latest current supported Kubernetes version. So as you can see, the 1.15 is the probably widely acceptable at this time. Amazon supports 1.14 at this time, so we can notice that. By the way, it's such delaying in the latest version probably is the commonly topic or common not the same, but the feature for almost all the services provided by Amazon. But as you can see a bit later, Amazon provides a bit higher value of SLA. So this delay in the current supported version could be probably described like better support. Okay, so 1.17 is the current version as for today for native Kubernetes service. The number of miner supported version more or less equal from 2 to 3. It's okay. And there we also can see the release date of appropriate service depending on the cloud platform. Okay, and as we already mentioned, all the services are adopted or aligned with CNCF, appropriate foundation, Kubernetes conformance. That's okay. The next one, latest certified version by foundation, 1.13 is the same for all the providers. Okay, let's begin with quite interesting features which are different depending on the provider. Master upgrade process. I hope you all know that at the current moment, all the platforms provided more or less similar approach how to provide the Kubernetes service. I mean, master plane provided as a service. And the question is how to upgrade this master process. In case of Amazon, we have user initiated. It means there is some kind of manual work. We do not have a option how to automate that. Probably, unfortunately. The same case, the same approach is used by Microsoft Azure master process. Google Kubernetes Engine provided probably the most appropriate, most comfortable option that it could be automatically upgraded during the cluster maintenance window, but at the same time could be also user initiated. That we can see that Google Kubernetes Engine provided probably the most comfortable option for that. Nodes upgrade process. More or less the same picture could be seen there. I mean, in case of Amazon, we faced two more or less different options. I mean, when we are talking about unmanagement node groups and managed node groups, the approach more or less the same, but could be divided according to group characteristics. Only user initiated approach is used by Amazon Azure. I mean, not upgrade process. And the same situation, I mean, automatic upgrade by default. which could be also turned off and performed during the cluster maintenance window can be initiated in case of Google Kubernetes engine. So the situation looks more or less the same. Google provides a higher level of automation. Container runtime, only Docker in case of Amazon Elastic Container Service. A kind of or adopted Docker or Docker with some additional features is used by Microsoft Azure. Docker by default provided by Google Kubernetes Engine, but additional to that, we can use Containerd. And as you can see, the native Kubernetes platform provides a lot of additional options like Erkatelet, and in ideal case, any runtime that implements container runtime interface and native Kubernetes platform could also use, as you probably know, Windows Docker based approach. Okay, good. Let's move on. High availability when it comes to master control plane. Amazon, the native and mostly used option is deployment across multiple availability zones. That's more or less typical for any kind of Amazon deployments. Microsoft Azure doesn't say any about that. So Azure provides some kind of availability when it comes to Kubernetes service, but it is not described in the documentation. Pretty specific case, you know. Google Kubernetes Engine, multi-zonal clusters as an option. The second option, only Google Kubernetes Engine provides multi-regional clusters. I mean the managed replicas in multiple zones and cluster. So the level of high availability is significantly higher in case of Google Kubernetes Engine. Master control plane SLA, more or less equal, but Amazon provides a bit higher level. Okay. And typical question and quite useful. I mean, what about the pricing? At this current time, only Amazon takes additional money for Masterplane service. But it could be pretty useful to mention that a couple of months ago, Amazon provides significant discount in payment of this service. It sounds pretty good. Azure does not take additional payment for master nodes. The same situation with Google, but I have heard it's not proved information, but it seems like some kind of true, that starting summer, Google will also take some kind of additional payment. Just to take a look at the chat. That's right. Okay, good. Thank you for your updates. So from pricing point of view, all the platforms also are looking almost more or less at the same level of pricing. Okay. Guys, please do not hesitate to provide your updates and questions, not only in chat, but also by voice. It would be also good. Okay, GPU support. More or less the same situation across all the platforms. Based on NVIDIA, of course, and it requires installation of additional drivers and plugins. Master component log collection, optional in case of Amazon, could be used the native service of monitoring, I mean Amazon CloudWatch. Optional also in case of Microsoft Azure, right? Could be sent to Azure monitoring. Optional, but turn it on by default, stack driver, I mean, in case of Google Kubernetes engine. Okay, performance metrics, optional. When it comes to Google Kubernetes engine. So you can see that the monitoring and performance metrics options are more or less the same across the platforms. Health monitoring. Not good approach is used by Amazon and Microsoft Azure. Known, definitely known in case of Azure. Autoscaling group support in case of Amazon platform. Much more better looks Google in this at this point. We can implement node auto repair option, and this option already enabled by default. So the health monitoring looks much better in case of Google platform. That's good. Like a short summarizing regarding the general options described here. By the way, I definitely shared the slides after the meeting. Community meeting, and you will be able to use that information and these notes in your project work and your everyday routines. Okay, just for a short summarizing, you can see that at this point, I mean at point of general information, Google platform looks a bit more interesting, a bit more stable, more automated, etc., a bit more comfortable than Amazon and Microsoft Azure. Okay, the next section is about the service limits, probably the most interesting section. Maximal number of clusters, 100 per region. Case of Amazon, it could be also increased by request. 100 also in case of Microsoft Azure. 50 per zone plus 50 regional clusters in case of Google Kubernetes cluster. Probably the more flexible approach provided by Google. Max nodes per cluster. About around 1,000 nodes per cluster in case of Amazon. This limit could be also increased by appropriate request. A lot of limitations in case of Microsoft Azure. It depends on virtual machines availability set, sort of network, sort of implementation approach of skill set, etc., etc., etc. 5,000 in case of Google Kubernetes Engine, 1,000 if using GKE Ingress controller. So, okay. The maximal nodes per node, or per node pool or group, 100 provided by Amazon, 100 in case of Azure Kubernetes service, and 1,000 in case of Google. The leader, probably Google, in this, from this point of view, Google again. Maximum node pools groups per cluster. A bit not documented in case of Google, and around 10 in case of Azure and Amazon. The next one is probably the most interesting. Probably the most of you, if you have a chance to work with Kubernetes on Amazon, faced with limitations regarding the number of pods per one node. Quite interesting and tricky case we have in case of Amazon. So the number of pods deployed on one node is not the stable and depends on the node type and the sort of applied configuring networks. It depends on the number of elastic network interfaces and several additional constraints. Okay, so sometimes we can face the situation when we face it the limit of number of pods deployed on more or less powerful instance included in Kubernetes cluster on Amazon. Okay, a bit different situation in Microsoft and Google. Native Kubernetes recommends 100 pod per one node, but it could be configurable. So comments regarding the service limits. Most of these limits are more or less straightforward. A couple are not. The most interesting approach is using by including EC2 instances, as you can see in case of Amazon. And sometimes this limitation could not be avoided by implementation of standard approaches, and avoiding such limitation could be pretty tricky. So in my personal point of view, not only in my personal point of view, this limit could be considered like more or less critical by selection of the most appropriate or most comfortable cloud platform. Okay, networking and security, sorts and types of network plugins and Kubernetes network interfaces. The native implementation provided by Amazon, AWS, VPC, CNI. In case of Microsoft Azure, we can select two options, Kubernetes or Azure CNI, and Kubernetes in case of Google implementation. The same, Kubernetes is the default option when it comes to native Kubernetes. Role-based access control, required in case of Amazon. More or less the same situation in case of Microsoft Azure. All base access control enabled by default. Enabled also by default in Google. Could be disabled and enabled again at any time. So more flexibility, as you can see, is provided by, again, by Google Cloud Platform. Network policy. I mean the native cloud policy, not enabled by default by Amazon. Calico. Probably the most popular appropriate solution at this time. I mean, when it comes to network policies, Calico could be installed manually in case of Amazon. Network policies not enabled by default also in case of Microsoft Azure platform. Could be enabled at any time during the operation. Calico plus Azure CNI, or as a different option, Azure policy. Also not enabled by default on Google platform. Can be enabled, and Calico is the standard option. Additional to that, we can apply and configure pod security policy support. It requires installing of additional controller installation in case of Amazon. Can be installed at any time on Azure platform, and the same situation is in case of Google. Pod security policy can be installed at any time on Google platform. Private or public IP addresses for cluster Kubernetes API, public by default. Such approach provided by Amazon. Private only addresses are optional. Public is also by default in case of Microsoft. Optional is not default, but also could be used. Public in case of Google, of course. And optional approach is also available in case of Google Kubernetes Engine. Okay. Public IP addresses for nodes. Only Amazon provides such option. Microsoft Azure and Google Kubernetes Engine do not. When we potentially will need such option like public IP addresses for nodes, the most commonly used case is for some kind of troubleshooting, you know. So sometimes this approach, this option could be very, very useful. Nobody provides port-to-port traffic encrypted process. It looks not good, but it is the fact so far. Firewalls for cluster Kubernetes API, only whitelisting option at the current moment. And again, Google looks as a leader when we are talking about the read-only root file system on nodes. Such option not supported by Microsoft and Amazon, and supported in case of container OS on Google. It could be also pretty useful in some specific cases. Okay, good. A couple of nodes, you can also read those nodes after the meeting when I will provide you with the slides. Good. The next section, it's all about the image services. Okay, so all the providers using appropriate services to keep the container images, and there are different options how to tag, version, and secure the images. So the situation looks more or less the same in case of any providers. The security is also more or less equal in case of different type of providers. The only one pretty interesting point is that Amazon, as usual, uses the own native approach, I mean identity access management. Network endpoints are acceptable, publicly acceptable in case of all the providers. Yep, so it's more or less equal across the all providers. The base, the main storage for container images, logically are the object storages in case of Google and Amazon. And I don't know why it is not documented in case of Azure. Probably the same, I hope, that Microsoft use also the object storage for container registries. Storage securities, not also documented by Microsoft, but a lot of options in case of Google and Microsoft. Okay. Only, on another hand, only Microsoft provides the possibility to sign the images. It could be also more or less useful for some specific cases. Only Amazon supports immutable image tags. Image scanning service. Probably you have heard about such option. It could be also useful in some particular situation when we would like to scan our container images for some kind of vulnerabilities. It could be also implemented on different platforms. In case of needed. SLA provided for that service is equal in case of Amazon and Microsoft, and not documented, what is interesting, in case of Google Kubernetes platform. Okay. A couple of comments regarding container registry options could be also found here, and a couple of updates which you could also can read after the meeting. So just again, the slides will be provided and attached to meeting minutes after this my short speech. So just to summarize, at this current moment, in my personal opinion, and not only my personal opinion, probably Google Kubernetes Engine looks like a leader across the most important, most famous platforms. Microsoft Kubernetes service, Azure service. It's quite specific, but also could be used. And from different points of view, Amazon Elastic Container Kubernetes Service probably provides a lot of features and more comfortable integrated with different Amazon services. So the selection is yours. So all the services could be used for production deployment of Kubernetes. Thank you. That's all. If you have some questions, please do not hesitate to ask me.
Andrei Bondar speaking. First of all, thank you for a wonderful presentation. A lot of useful information here. The question is, did we cover auditing for Kubernetes clusters on different clouds? Maybe I missed that. If we didn't cover that, can you highlight maybe some specific settings which might be needed to set up auditing? Meaning, should it be set up enforced in cluster creation time, or maybe for some clouds it can be enforced during the operating the cluster? Can you add some details on that?
Probably I didn't get completely your question. Could you please repeat
auditing,
again?
Auditing, I mean auditing, gathering the information about activities against cluster, with pods, with deployments, with everything. I mean auditing.
We are talking about exactly the installation process or operation in general.
So I
mentioned regarding the auditing and managing, but probably not detailed. Mm-hmm. So the main point probably could be characterized at that. Google implementation is more, how to say it, native. Mm-hmm. So all the approaches, or almost all the approaches which is used in native or general, I mean platform agnostic implementation, mm-hmm, on Kubernetes could be also used and commonly used in Google implementation. It's not a surprise because, you know, still Google is still the probably the most active contributor in Kubernetes code base. What about the Azure? As you probably know, Microsoft Azure is quite specific platform. And this specific could be faced in any cases and any types of deployments. As for example, I didn't mention that, but even network topology, mm-hmm, even network topology in case of Microsoft Azure is quite specific. So subnets are not isolated, I mean, between the availability zones. On the other hand, such cases strongly not recommended to use in case of Amazon and Google. What I would like to say, Google is almost, Google implementation is almost like native Kubernetes service. Azure implementation is more specific, even in case of auditing and logging. Mm-hmm. And Amazon implementation is somewhere between Google and Azure implementation. What about the tools? Each platform uses own tools for auditing, logging, and health checking, etc., etc., etc. Something like that. About Oracle Cloud and IBM Cloud. Quite interesting question. It could be considered like the topic as for one of the upcoming session. I did not investigate Oracle Cloud and IBM before the meeting today, but I definitely and with pleasure can spend the time and investigate those two platforms as well.
What about Kubernetes and maybe OpenStack Cloud? I honestly haven't ever heard about such solution, but maybe it could be interesting as well.
Okay, it also could be included for the upcoming session. So, you know, it would be good to have appropriate slides and statistics and metrics, etc., etc. Okay, VMware, Photon OS, good. Guys, we already have the scope for the one of the upcoming session. Good. I made already the notes and I will be prepared for the next time. For some specific, cases or platforms or something like that. Good, thank you.